Hi, I'm Dr. Phil Hoffman, and joining us right now on InReach, we have Barbara Hartley. Barbara is from the Downtown Arts District here in Orlando. Good morning.
Hi, good morning.
So let's talk a little bit about the Downtown Arts District and City Arts. Can you kind of explain who you are, what you do, and a little bit of the history?
Absolutely. So the Downtown Arts District is a parent company to City Arts. And the history is we started in 2002 in partnership with the City of Orlando. You might remember the LizArt program where there was lizard sculptures throughout Orlando. And that evolved into creating Downtown Arts District. And so in 2002, we were incorporated. And then in 2006, we opened City Arts Factory on the corner of Orange and Pine. Recently, in the last 2 years, we moved to the oldest building in downtown Orlando, which is called City Arts Orlando now, but it is the Rogers Keeney Building. So it's the oldest commercial building. It's a Victorian building. It's lovely for gallery space. And we do performances, music events, storytelling, as well as a lot of art exhibits.
So, you know, as we got into the world here back in March where everything changed for most arts organizations, you know, one of the great things I think about sort of what you all do is you do have some space, right? That's kind of a necessary part of it. And so typically you could have a little bit more social distancing, but I imagine at first it was probably quite a change for you all. How did you adapt?
Yeah, well, so we actually hung an entire exhibit days before the shutdown. So it was really sad because it was a beautiful exhibit in partnership with OUC. So we quickly did videos of each of the gallery exhibits so people could enjoy them from home. We also adapted our website to include images of every single piece of art. So that show was up for 2 months during the shutdown. And some people purchased artwork online. We also did a lot of virtual programming. And we are probably one of the braver, earlier adapters of going back to work and opening the gallery. So when retail opened, we opened the galleries on May 12th. And we've been doing programming since, but with a lot of protocol in place so that people are wearing masks and, you know, everyone signs a waiver. We also do our openings by appointment. So there's never more than 40% of capacity in the building. And our capacity is just over 200.
So it's a real, it's a real challenge for most arts organizations nowadays because they're not able to do the same kinds of volume of people coming through or coming to events and that sort of thing. One of the things, obviously, openings are a little bit different, but the actual show, once it's hung, you have a little bit more time where you can sort of arrange for people to come through, right? Does that help in this situation?
Yeah, so we do two things. We do the opening. Now we're doing it for 4 hours instead of 3 hours. Mm-hmm. And then we're open actually 6 days a week. So we have our regular hours, and it's Tuesday through Sunday. So it gives people time to come out on their own. And really, it's been it's kind of self-regulated, because a lot of people aren't going out, so they prefer to watch it online. So generally, we have an average of 25 to 50 people a day, which is low compared to, previous standards. But there's still a lot of people looking for things to do that would be considered a safe way of, experiencing the arts. So there are very few touch points, and we have social distancing markers with really fun artistic sayings. So it's been a good experience for both the artists and the attendees looking for something to do.
And I would imagine that we're probably already starting to see some offerings of shows or some offerings of exhibits that are COVID related. Are you able to talk about anything you've seen so far that you think is really neat that is sort of a reaction to COVID?
Yeah, well, so we did our first exhibit once we opened was the Pompeii Takeover. So you may be familiar with the Orlando Science Center's Pompeii exhibit that's going to be coming in October. It was delayed, but we had partnered with them to do 6 exhibits in the gallery. So some of the art was actually COVID-related with, you know, masks, and it was also an interesting time when you're talking about a disaster such as, you know, the Pompeii eruption to today opening it, you know, during COVID. So lots of conversation around that.
Well, one of the things I always find fascinating, Barbara, is, you know, it seems like difficult times always result in great art. And so I wonder, you know, what your thought is about what are the likely reactions in the art world to what we're going through now, and what kind of changes might we see in the future, do you think?
Yeah, I think, you know, art always speaks to current events, you know, so we're seeing a lot of topics from, you know, political topics to, you know, the conversation about race and COVID. There's a lot going on in the arts, and, you know, and it's just a way to express the current times and get out different feelings and emotions now around the topics. And we actually started a new program just last week. It was virtual, but we invited 5 Black artists and 2 performers to kick off a year of listening. So we're gonna be listening to Black artists. You know, what have their experiences been, and what can we do different, you know, as institutions, as, you know, people involved in the profession of the arts. So I think, you know, there's a lot of positivity coming out of it. And, you know, while we are a safe space and have a lot of inclusiveness as part of our mission, we can still do better. So, you know, we're continuing to have the conversations and come up with new programming.
Now, you mentioned earlier a lot of the things that you're doing in the online world. Let's talk a little bit about that, the pivot to that, and how that has gone for you in terms of adapting and doing more things online.
Yeah, so, you know, we haven't done a lot of online programming previously because most people came to visit the location in person, but we've adapted our website. We do on-site openings as well as virtual openings. So the on-site, like for instance, we have an opening tomorrow, and people can see it throughout the month through September 13th. And then we'll do 2 virtual exhibits online. So we've had to become proficient in, you know, technology, also learning how to use the equipment, you know, what works, what doesn't work. Obviously, Zoom has been a big help for everyone, but it's been a learning curve. And I think people who aren't safe, feeling safe going out, appreciate being able to experience it online and still purchase the art and help, you know, to support our local artists.
And that's another key issue, not only in terms of visual art, but musicians and performers. It's been a difficult time for people who make their living by
Yes.
being part of the arts. What have you seen in your world in terms of what artists are trying to deal with in their own world during COVID?
Yeah, I think everyone's looking for opportunities and you know, jobs, paying jobs. So that's one of the reasons we went ahead and opened when we did, to give that opportunity to the artists. We also did some virtual programming. You know, so I just encourage everyone to support our local artists. You know, performances have been online. We have a lot of great groups here in Central Florida, and we've tried to partner with them. We partnered with the Timucua Arts Foundation just this past week, where we did an outside event in our courtyard between the Celt and City Arts. And that was really beautiful. It was a little warm, but people appreciated being able to, you know, order from the Celt and have a nice experience listening to the performance. It was very healing as well.
So one of the things we're hoping, Barbara, is at some point we will be able to go back to, you know, more of what we think of as normal. So let's mm-hmm. talk a little bit about City Arts plans. Once things kind of return to normal, what shows are coming? What events are you expecting to have in the future, maybe in the next year or so, that you think are really going to be of keen interest to folks here in town?
Sure. So, I mean, we've been continuing with the events, but since COVID and our experience with online, I believe we will continue to use that as a tool, just because really it enhances the reach. So more people can enjoy the artwork and have an opportunity to purchase it. You know, we're also getting people from out of state that are joining, you know, the conversation or watching from a distance. So I think we'll continue doing that. Upcoming shows, we have a great show planned for this month, Ollie Ollie Oxen Free. It's a performance and visual arts, and it opens this week, but we'll have another opening next week, and we'll be able to show that online. In December, we are planning a 12 by 12 show where we have 12 artists submit 12 by 12 pieces of art. And they're generally local artists. Sometimes we'll invite some traveling artists. But we're also working with the Orlando Weekly on a cartoon exhibit curated by our good friend, Kyle Eagle. I don't know if you know him, but he's great. He loves the arts. And you know, we're just looking to be more inclusive and include, you know, all backgrounds in the arts like we have in the past. You know, just more curated and more storytelling and conversations behind, you know, what's happening in the arts.
Yeah, I think the biggest disappointment for me, Barbara, as a person that loves to go to art exhibits, is I love to go to those openings, you know, and have the food and chat with everybody. So it's tough now in this current environment where you can still do it, but it's just not the same, right? In terms of the number of people. Well, let's talk a little bit about how folks can find more information if they're watching this morning and they're not familiar with City Arts. How do they find out what you're up to and to watch some of your videos?
Sure. Well, we would love more people to get engaged with us through social media. So people can find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, as well as our website, it's downtownartsdistrict.com. And so on the website, you'll see all of the current exhibits. You can see walkthroughs. You can purchase art and artistic retail. So it's great for gifts. And we also, when we reopen, we will have the venue available for private and you know, special events, you know, such as weddings and business events.
Great. Well, thank you for joining us this morning, Barbara. We appreciate you being here. And best of luck to you as you continue to have great art in City Arts.
Thank you so much. And thank you for supporting all the local arts groups as well as our local artists.
Absolutely. Very, very important. We want everybody to be able to still be there when this all ends and we can go back to normal. So thank you, Barbara. If you have any more questions about City Arts, you can definitely visit the website and we'll have more information about it on our website here at WUCF.org. I'm Dr. Phil Hoffman. Thank you for joining us. More of InReach coming up next. Take a quick stroll through the streets of downtown New Smyrna Beach and you will quickly notice that the arts are a big part of the community.
This area just is. It's visually very attractive. It's got all sorts of things. Inland, river, ocean. You can get almost anything here for stimulus.
I think there were a lot of people here that wanted to do something with art and make it more of just a hobby and make it part of the town, and it just went on from there.
It's just a very tight community and always has been for artists. There's an artist workshop in town that was created 55 years ago. We have the Atlantic Center for the Arts, which is a very big nationally known organization. We have lots of galleries and other things that function here. And we, the Hub on Canal, try and fill that middle ground, and we're for the community. We want people to come in here, take art classes, and in that way, we're paying our community back.
We are going to be talking with JoAnn Newman, who is the CEO of the Orlando Science Center. Welcome.
Thank you so much.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the Science Center. Obviously, very, very well known in town. Talk a little bit about the history and the mission of the Science Center. What are you all about there?
Well, Phil, as you know, but some people don't know, our mission is to inspire science learning for life. And really, we strive to make science engaging and accessible and fun. And we do that through sort of a set of assets, really, that we have here at the center. It's through some of these amazing exhibits that we have, permanent exhibits. We bring in traveling exhibits. We have giant screen theaters. We have a telescope up on the top of the building and an amazing observatory. And we have an incredible team of people who really work to design programs both for the general public and for schools and school children and teachers. We do a lot of teacher training. So I think, though, in general, you know, some of our methodology that we use, we introduce problem-based learning. And what we're trying to do is really teach this next generation how to solve problems and that it's okay to fail. What did you learn from that failure? And, you know, I think in the end, we're just trying to help create this next generation of STEM professionals, because this will be the group that, you know, when they grow up, they're going to be discovering vaccines and they're going to cure disease and they're going to save our coral reefs and they're going to be the ones traveling to Mars. So it's really about, you know, we try to have a lot of fun and be engaging in the work we do, but we take it seriously because it's a very important mission to help create this next generation who's going to help us solve all of the complex problems that we face.
You know, like so many other arts and culture organizations, one of the challenges in the current environment is normally on any given day, if you walk into the Science Center, the place is packed, there's a lot of activity going on, there's tons of people. And of course, that's exactly the opposite, right, in a pandemic of the kind of environment you can usually expect to find. So how has the whole global pandemic aspect of this changed the way that you've worked in the last few months?
Well, it's been rough. Phil, and it's been rough for so many businesses and so many people. And it started with, we had to shut the Science Center down for 3 months. We're actually, I think, one of the more fortunate arts and culture groups, being on the museum side, that we were able to open back up. So we're fortunate in that way. But we've had to make tremendous change, starting with all of our health and safety protocol, which we've invested a lot into and takes, you know, additional time, additional money, additional staff to make that all work. One of our bright spots, honestly, was our summer camp. So we were able to run summer camp. So we saw more than 2,000 students this summer, Phil, we were able to support. And I do remember on the first day, the parents and the kids coming up that first day of week one, and I don't know who was happier, the parents or the children, but it was wonderful. It sort of re-energized all of us as a staff to hear the sound of children back in the building and to be able to support that many children and families this summer. And we did it in an absolute safe way. One of the negative things that happened to us was we were supposed to have gotten the blockbuster exhibit Pompeii this summer, and it got stuck in another museum in the state of Washington due to the pandemic. But what we did was we converted that huge traveling hall into additional classroom spaces so that we could handle children in a safe and an efficient way, because we had to reduce our capacity in order to give, the 6 feet distancing and to keep the class sizes very small and to protect everybody. But so in the end, we kind of turned that problem into an advantage to be able to turn that into classroom space. So I think camp was kind of the bright spot. And to your point, we're so used to having the Science Center packed in the summer and filled with a lot of families and children. And it's been a very different summer. Our attendance on the general admission side has been about 20% of what we saw last summer. So part of that is, you know, some of the safety measures and the capacity limiting steps we've taken, but we could definitely do more. It's just people are nervous about coming out.
Well, and, you know, I'm sure when the parents and the kids were coming for the beginning of camp, if you're a child and you've been looking forward to going to camp at the Science Center all the last couple of months, and all of a sudden you're not even sure that's going to happen, you're probably really excited that it did happen. So I can certainly appreciate the challenge there. And from your position as the executive in charge of the organization, this has got to be a particular challenge in the sense that, you know, the normal ways that you raise and generate revenue are kind of muted now as a result of this, but you still have a building, you still have a staff, you still have lots of expenses. It's really got to be a challenging time for somebody in your role.
It is. It's challenging. You feel the weight of it sometimes because we have had to reduce staff. We've had to cut back on hours somewhat, and you know, we're taking all of those measures. But I will say, I think we have a very resilient team here, a very creative team. And we said, you know, our words of 2020 are adapt and pivot. And we continue to do that because what the school systems do also has a pretty large impact on the Science Center. And yeah, and if you recall, I totally agree with what you say about the beginning of summer. And they had also been home since March, mm-hmm. right? Doing the unexpected all at once. Everybody's at home, parents and children, and trying to figure out this online learning. So it was great to be able to provide that for the summer. And then as we move into the school year, one of the things that we've pivoted on again is to offer support to families who've chosen online learning. So if they're not comfortable doing face-to-face schooling yet, but perhaps they were with us this summer, they saw all the safety and health measures, they know how well it went. If they're willing to come to the Science Center, even if it's for a day or two, if they need a break, we can support these children in terms of their online school learning. And we've already, now that officially launches next week, but with these first 2 weeks where Orange County moved to online only, we've already launched that. And it's going really well. And I think as we move further into this, depending on how long it lasts, we might have more families take us up on that.
So one of the things that I was most looking forward to about this summer, JoAnn, was coming to see the Pompeii exhibit. I don't want people to get the wrong idea. It's still happening, just not as planned, right? Not in the timeline that planned.
Exactly. It was supposed to be here this summer, but it will now arrive at the very end of October. And in some ways, that's probably much better timing than if it had been able to make it this summer, given everything, you know, we were going through. So it'll open at the very end of October. It'll be here November, December, and January. And we're so excited about it, Phil. We had generated a lot of momentum going into the summer around Pompeii. It's an amazing exhibit. It's considered a blockbuster exhibit in our industry. And it's really, I think it just has an amazing story when you think about Pompeii and the volcano and how so quickly that city was destroyed, but yet it was perfectly preserved. And we've been able to learn so much from what was preserved. And that's what the exhibit will really tell, the story of Pompeii and the art and the history and the culture. And it's pretty amazing, a very sophisticated city, considering it was more than 2,000 years ago.
Well, that's I think the good news in all this, JoAnn, is, you know, I was disappointed that I didn't get to go see Pompeii in the summertime, but at least I know it's still coming, so I'm excited about that. I'm looking forward to that. And you know, the good news is, as you mentioned, you know, folks can still come to the Science Center. You're still open. And so if they're looking for that, something that they want to do with their kids and they want to go out and be in a safe environment, obviously you've been open for a while now, so you've got the protocols down and there's evidence, right? So you're the science center, so you have evidence that things are going well.
Yes. I mean, when we first put out all of our protocols, we said we're following the science. I mean, we are the science center. We need to do that. And it's worked beautifully, Phil. And it's making sure that you do wear a mask. And those children wash their hands all day long. I had a parent tell me, my child loves it. And they came home and said, but I must have washed my hands 100 times, Mom. And I said, yes, that's by definition, that's what's happening. So it can be done where we have enough space to keep people safely distant. And, you know, the wonderful thing about Pompeii is we can execute on timed ticketing for that exhibit. It's what I'd call a COVID-friendly exhibit because there is a lot to see and take in and absorb around the story. It's not a traditional hands-on interactive exhibit. It's a little different, and I think it's going to work really well given the time period that it'll be here.
Well, JoAnn, we're just about out of time. If folks want to find out more about the Science Center, the hours, when Pompeii is happening, where do they go to get that information?
The website, osc.org, Phil, is where you'll find all of our information. And I hope people, when they're ready, we are open, as you said. We really welcome people to come in and experience it for themselves.
Well, thank you for joining us this morning, JoAnn. We appreciate your time. JoAnn Newman from the Orlando Science Center. Absolutely a very enjoyable tour for you, for your kids. And so we encourage you to go to the Science Center's website and look to where you can go in the future. Thank you, JoAnn. That's it for this episode of InReach. I'm your host, Dr. Phil Hoffman. Thank you for tuning in, and we'll be back with more arts and culture next week.